before you address the young demographics, I have something to tell you, and that is, I always ask my young 18-year-old student something about the chief guest who's coming in. So I asked him, I said, what do you think of our chief guest, the young man standing in the aisle? And he says, he is Modiji's Krishna. So we are giving you a book by
of our work, how can we make India more contemporary with the rest of the world? We've all gone through education. I remember what we studied in Commerce College or in law or chartered accountancy. While it's been great and very useful in my work, 30 years in the private sector, now 3 years in government. But clearly the world has changed, the world has evolved into something very new, something very different. And in this new age, unless India keeps pace with what's happening worldwide, we'll get left behind, we'll get left behind very badly. And therefore, as this government came in, we had two choices before us. One was a choice of those quick fix solutions, which would have looked very good, which would have looked very, very exciting, which would have probably given us a lot of brownie points and a lot of temporary happiness to the people of India. Or we had the choice of designing an innovative future for the country. I'll take an analogy from, let's say, your own premises. This is a beautiful building, the India Bulls one, it's called. It's an iconic building. I think it defined Lower Parel area and gave it an identity. Now you're, of course, adding to that identity with an innovation district or design district. But just look back. Today it's a beautiful building. But just look back in time, when before this was constructed, they must have had to dig really deep to make the foundation of this building, because it's a 10, 12 story building, maybe more, I don't know, 20 story building probably. Yes. Now a 20 story building could not have had a small foundation, it must have been a very deep foundation. And before they could make the foundation, they must have really dug into the ground and taken out a lot of muck, a lot of dirt. They must have had to dispose of that muck so that it's not like, I don't think there's any muck lying around here, right? So somebody has disposed of that muck. Then they designed a very robust foundation. And that foundation had to be such that it could take a tall building, it could be earthquake resistant, it would not be porous, so that water or anything else cannot seep into it. It has to be long-lasting. It has to be safe and secure for all of us to be standing here. And during this whole process, the designing of the foundation, the making of the foundation, it must have been a very messy affair all across. As the building came up, it must have been even messier. Cement and steel, and you walk carefully and you wear a helmet and whatnot. Duck if you see something suddenly popping out of a crevice in the wall or something. And then the building started getting complete, the finishing work, and this is what you have here today. The promoters of this project chose to make a beautiful future for your school. But before that, they put in years and years of effort to make this happen. Indu Shani is what she is today, not out of the blue suddenly. She's put in 40 years. 30 years of pain and interacting with how many thousands of Piyush Goyals. You must have really troubled her a lot. And today she's giving back to your school. But when she made this whole school, she went through the same pain. The designing of the various classrooms, the curriculum, the course, how she's going to select students, how she's going to make the school a success. And that's the path that this government has taken. What we've tried to do is do a root cause analysis, see what this country needs most, and work the country's future through a very systematic long-term program which will impact India's lives not in the short run but in the long run, in a very big way, in a very significant way. And design, innovation, entrepreneurship, all of this truly defines in some sense what we also are planning or hoping for the future of India. After all, in each of the things, you spoke about coal production, for example. We moved from coal shortages to coal surplus maybe in a year and a half or 2 years. It's not as if the country didn't have coal. It's not as if we've replaced all the workers in the coal mines or the management of the coal mines. Everything is exactly what it was. And some people used to ask me, even before I became a minister on all the Arnab Goswami shows, then why does government fail, or why do companies fail? Why is the public sector undertakings not doing well? And I remember in those old days, I used to say the problem before the country is only vision and leadership. And that's the only thing that has changed after the new government came. There's a vision, a target, a goal before the nation. And there's decisive, bold leadership steering that change. And within a year and a half or two, if the country could move from shortage of coal to surplus coal, shortage of power to surplus power, renewable energy has taken a huge leg up. If you look at any statistic, by the way, all the statistics were wrong in Hindu. Pretty outdated statistics. So you need to have a little more research effort going into the. But nothing bad. They were all understated, so it's okay. If something was overstated, I would have had to be worried. But today, it's not 3.6% deficit. I have power coming out of my ears. So I love to see all the air conditioners working full-fledged here because electricity is getting consumed. Otherwise, we don't have enough market for the electricity India produces today. And Yes Bank may have an NP or two because of that. But it's just the mindset. The limitations in our country were only in our mind. It's not in our ability. It's not as if we could not have done this earlier. It's all of us in this room who have to determine and decide our future. Each one of you has a Bill Gates sitting within you, or a Sorel sitting within you, or a Warren Buffett sitting with you. It's in your desire to make a difference that will rest your success, that will define your future. And clearly the future is best done when you do it very, very systematically. As I said, you have to remove the cobwebs out of your mind. You have to open your mind to fresh air. Design your own future, plan your own future, what your best cut out to be. I mean, we've all seen Three Idiots, right? We can't literally put a square peg into a square hole. This is what Three Idiots was all about. Each one of us will have to define and determine what our future is, where we are best suited. And that's the beauty of this institute that we are standing here. It allows you to design your own future, to innovate in your career. Prepares you for entrepreneurship, prepares you to become managers of your destiny. And in that sense, the need of the hour as the country evolves will be to redesign educational curriculums, will be to look at how we need to prepare the nation. Should we all necessarily have to go through a graduation and then become an unemployed graduate? Because with all the new artificial intelligence coming in, with all the new technologies overtaking us faster than we can probably even imagine, I think the days of structured jobs in government or structured jobs in manufacturing large conglomerates is changing. Particularly with 3D manufacturing, I can't for the life of me imagine whether we'll have those large producing plants anymore in the world. It won't make sense. You'll actually probably bring in a machine and the machine comes to your home. I'm just letting my imagination run wild. But I can imagine one day a machine will come home and ask me, what kind of a car do you want to have? And I may say, look, I want a stretch limousine with this spec, this color and whatnot, have you? Or maybe like the young man showed me on his simulation or the 3D projection on his, what is that called? Virtual reality. And through that I'll be able to design the car. And 3D instruments of manufacturing will help create that car right there before my very eyes, and then in the middle of it, like we do in interior decoration, no, but this color is not matching with the sofas, the curtain is not matching with the sofa, so you change it. Only this time around it may probably be done much faster than it used to be done earlier. So things are changing, things are evolving faster than this, we can catch up. And with a billion plus people, over 400-500 students, at age groups which would be near about similar to the students in this institute, the country will have to really look for fresh ideas, new ideas. And in that sense, a model like ISDI or ISME has huge potential to multiply, to grow, to expand. And to my mind, it will prepare you for a truly better future. Because gone are the days where structured education could prepare everybody to face the challenges of life. I think the day and age that we are living in today, frankly, probably beyond 8th standard, I don't see any reason to have a very structured curriculum. You are taking students from 12th, which is great by itself. But as I let my mind wander into the future, I think at the age of 12 or 13, once you cross the 8th standard, people are starting to think what they want to do, where they want to be, what kind of a career they want to pursue. Some of the initiatives you showed me about bringing children from less privileged sections of society into your institute, grooming them, preparing them for a better future, helping them understand the virtue of education, not to drop out of school. Some of the designs that of your academic curricula that I saw today, in terms of the boardroom where students interact, even in the midst of a board meeting, or the oval room where we saw different subjects could possibly be taught or different programs could be taught and then integrated into one. All of these are truly innovative. I mean, I'm myself thinking what I should be doing to try and re-educate myself. Or maybe come back to school. Maybe we could actually create a program for politicians. Each one of us needs to re-engineer our skills. We need a continuous learning process. I've been going to management programs for the last, before I became a minister, between 2011 and 2014. Continuously, every summer I was at a different school. Short programs, it just rejuvenates you, prepares you once again for the challenges of life. And in that sense, frankly, I believe you're all privileged to be over here. Far better than going to a school or college with just education by rote or preparing to get a rank, as I must have done once upon a time. Of course, I was working along with my education, so less time to prepare really. But practical education, the way as I could see it here, prepares you for life far better than any academic curriculum in the college or school. And I'm a beneficiary of that person. I started working when I was in the 1980s, or about 11th standard. Just towards the fag end of my 11th standard when I was in Jay, a sister college of HR. And I was planning to do engineering, by the way. The same three-year story. Family full of engineers. You get good marks in 10th standard, so you take admission in Jay because it's the best college in science. Start preparing, go to Agarwal classes, if any of you remembers or knows about it. So I was a student at Agarwal classes. Professor Karkhanis, I don't know where he's teaching maths, and the typical routine. We all get into that rut. And somewhere in January of 1980, I remember my brother was then studying at MIT, and also an engineer, same route, IIT Kanpur, top there, go to MIT, the same standard story that we find in our lives, in our families. And we discussed and we said, we'll do entrepreneurship, we'll set up our own business. So he said, get out of engineering and get into commerce. And that's how I actually switched in 12th standard and went to HR from JN, from science to commerce, and started working simultaneously to start a very small scale business, very, very small scale. And that learning, that practical hands-on learning has held me in good stead right until today. So when we design the GST framework, I know jolly well where are the loopholes where people are going to come and ask for price. What do we need to do to make sure that things get system driven? Or how transparency can help save people from being pressurized or harassed, or terrorized also, if I may use that. So practical experience, which all of you are benefiting from, right in this institute, is going to really hold you in very, very good stead. It's going to help you do well in life. I hope to see each one of you as entrepreneurs, maybe go and take a loan from a bank for the first time, learn how to prepare a bank loan application as I did, sitting outside Union Bank of India on the stools there, taking the bank manager's help. What the hell does this mean? What do I have to do? How do I tally these numbers? And it's great to learn on the job, and which is the opportunity, I think, in a large measure you're getting in this institute. So you are privileged in that sense. And I'm sure each one of you will make outstanding citizens of our country. Each one of you will do us proud, just like the young girl Nirula, yes, who's designed the t-shirt which I had the privilege of wearing on 21st of June, only last month, barely a month ago, in Vizag, Vishakhapatnam, where I had gone for the International Yoga Day. And I didn't even know it comes out of the institute I'm going to visit barely 40 days after that. So truly a privilege for me to be amongst all of you. Lovely to meet all of you. I was told that you'd like to ask me a few questions, grill me a little bit, a la what, Arnab Goswami or Radhid Sardesai. But with the Radhid style, you won't get me to acknowledge that Modi is bad. Despite his best efforts, he's not been able to do that. But truly, it's a great moment in history that India is experiencing. We are going through difficult times in the world economy. India is that shining star which is outperforming the world economy. We saw the lovely simulated stock exchange dealing room. And if at all that's any barometer, it's at an all-time high. I wish I had invested in Yes Bank shares a few years ago. Probably I could retire for the rest of my life. But I'm happy doing what I am. Actually, at some stage, money loses purpose in life. And I'm glad that you're taking your students into the villages. Because until you get into the villages, until you see their lives, believe me, nobody likes to live in a slum. Nobody is happy to be deprived of electricity. Nobody is happy that a school doesn't have good teachers or good possible quality education. Nobody is happy carrying his mother or his wife on his shoulder and walking 12 kilometers before he can get health care. Some of you may remember reading about what happened in Odisha barely a couple of months ago. Nobody is happy with all that. It's circumstances that have maybe helped all of us board the train and some are left behind. And I'm glad that this school is also preparing you for those challenges. Because ultimately those challenges are our challenges. As the new Honorable President said, if any of you heard his acceptance speech last week or earlier this week, that bringing about change or improving the lives of the people of India or making India a superpower or meeting the aspirations of a billion people cannot be the job merely of the government. We will all have to participate. It will have to be a people's movement. Every section of society, teachers, administrators, students, our parents, our friends, everybody will have to collaborate in this effort. It's like the beads in a necklace. One bead goes out, the necklace gets out of sync. Or one crack in a wheel and the whole wheel is finished. And we are all cogs in that wheel. We are all a part of that necklace. All these various, I saw the Make in India program. You are working with the Skill India initiative. Our Power for All effort to make sure that every child gets electricity, every home in the country gets electricity at affordable prices. Our efforts to clean the environment, have a green India. The Swachh Bharat movement to make India clean. All of these may sound small, but each one has a deep meaning. And without each one of these, this necklace cannot be complete. And I'm glad that in that beautiful necklace, the ISDI and ISME is also a bead, which is helping to make that necklace.